Okay, so I'd like to call this work session to order. Can we have a roll call, please?
Here.
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 Here. And Councilmember House might be ill, so I don't know, Kathy, if you want. Oh, wait, wrong. Yes. You want to move over or Dale? Well, whatever. We'll figure that out. Okay. Is there any public comment on items not on the agenda today? Okay, seeing none, we'll just move right over to the work session. I'll put over to Mr. Armstrong.
Okay, Madam Mayor and members of the council, if you recall when we had our budget workshop in early February, one of the topics that we brought to your attention was the need to look at a new revenue source. And at that time, with the council, we talked about it, and the council decided that we would have a separate workshop just on that subject. So the purpose today is to talk about whether or not the council wants to look at a new revenue source, kind of the reasoning behind that, and then we're going to look and also to get public comment on that. And then we'll look for the council if you want to give us direction today. And I know this is a tough issue, and it may, you know, the council may want to get more public input before you make a final decision. But some of what we're going to do today, kind of the plan, assuming that's going to work, Bob. Is we're going to give you a kind of an overall picture of city finances, talk about why the council may want to consider a new revenue source, look at potential revenue options and voter thresholds, describe what's going on in the region and in the state in terms of what other communities are doing, and then potential options for the city council. And some of this will be repetitive a little bit from what we went over with you a month ago. But we felt for the public's benefit, it was important to kind of provide the basis of why we're suggesting the council look at this. But so I apologize that some of the slides you've seen before, at least in some formats. So first I want to talk a little about just the state of the city's finances. And as you know, over the last basically 4.5 to 5 years, we've been in a severe recession. As a result of that, it's reduced key revenues in most business sectors of the city. And I put business sectors because not just in the general fund, but we've seen it at the waterfront in terms of demand went down. At the airport, we saw a reduction in passenger count. Downtown parking saw a reduction. So in pretty much all areas of the city, we saw some reduction in revenues. But most severely has been in the general fund. We've made major cuts in service levels. We've cut personnel, and I'll go through that. And, of course, we've cut capital spending. We achieved wage and benefit concessions from all of our employee organizations, and that was a key part of how we got through the recession. And we're a smaller and we're a more efficient organization. But that doesn't mean we haven't cut services. I think part of it has been we become more efficient. But as you know, we've in many cases we've had to reduce or eliminate services we provide. And general fund reserves are still healthy. So I kind of want to go through these in a little more detail. You've seen these slides before, but again, this kind of shows you the impact of the recession. Back in 2007, sales taxes were about $20 million. We saw them drop in 2008, down more in 2009, down 2010. Altogether, we saw about a 20% drop in sales taxes from about $20 million down to $16 million. And now you're starting to see it come back up. And this last year, we hit 19.1. We'll hit 20 this year. But as you can imagine, if we had gone up 3% a year starting in 2007, we'd probably be, what, Bob, $26 million. So lost just in that one source of just normal growth, about $6 million annually. Property taxes, not as dramatic, but what we have seen is pretty much flat for the last 4 or 5 years. We've gone from 23.2 to 23.7. And we expect that revenue source to stay pretty much flat, 1, 2% growth for the foreseeable future. Bed tax revenues, also we saw a major drop in 2008 starting dropping. And again, we saw, I think, not quite 20%, but like a 16% drop. And now it's come back pretty healthy. And this last year, we actually exceeded where we were. But again, just imagine if this had just gone like this, we'd be way up there compared. And then, of course, how did we respond to that? And you've seen this slide before. This is 2009, and all of these are the adopted budget. There's two ways to look at budgets, either adopted or actual, and we felt the best way to look at it was just adopted. In 2009, the council adopted a budget of $108 million. By 2011, we had reduced it down to $99 million, so that's a drop of close to $9 million. It's starting to come back up, but still, you know, in a four-year period, we're still $2.2 million below where we were. Now, a lot of what happened here in 2011 were the employee concessions that we were able to achieve, reduction in capital, but also a lot, and I'll go through personnel cost. And in terms of where we made changes to the budget, all of these red areas are where there were reductions, and you can see the greatest reductions were in community development, and in parks and recreation, and in the administrative functions. And then you can see, even though we made reductions in terms of personnel, although not that substantial, that the public safety budgets, both fire and police, are up from where they were. And as you can see, fire's up about $1.3 million, and police is up about $2.8 million. And a lot of that has to do with PERS costs continuing to go up, as well as benefit, just other benefit costs. So even though we made reductions there, costs are still going up. A big way that we achieve the savings is in cutting positions. Our biggest cost is in people. You can see the general fund, we've dropped from about 663 at the height down to 594. And then these other funds also dropped. And in most cases, the other funds, those reductions are basically the ICS functions, the functions that provide services to the general fund, like the city fleet operation, the facility maintenance people, and then the IS people. So those basically are also as a result of the general fund cost. And if you go back in 2000, back all the way back to 1999, where basically we were, one of the other things that's happened here is we've actually added a lot of positions in this red area in two areas, one at the airport because of TSA requirements, and then in the utilities because of additional requirements, both in water and wastewater. So the general fund, you know, if you factor that in, general fund is actually, this would be even a bigger kind of cut. But again, this is the primary area we've achieved ongoing savings. If you just think about 80 positions at our average wage rate, you're probably talking $7-8 million of ongoing savings that we've achieved through those personnel reductions that will continue until we replace those positions, if we ever do. General fund reserves, I think, you know, I'm very proud of the way that the city's managed through this in terms of general fund reserves. In 2008, we had about $17.6 million. It has slowly crept up. And what that means really is we have balanced, or we have had a minor surplus every year since 2008 where it's gone up. And that's really because everybody just, you know, controlled expenses carefully. We adopted quickly. And general fund reserves are today at $22.4 million. Our goal with the council policy would be 26.4, so we're still below the council policy, but we're slowly recovering in the reserve area. Back up a couple. Part of the message here is we're talking to you about new revenues, not because the city's facing a crisis. The city is in good financial condition, basically. I mean, reserves are healthy. There's no immediate financial crisis. So this is much different than many of the headlines you read in the newspaper about some of the other cities in the state. We're not bringing this to you because there's a financial crisis. The city organization is smaller. It's more efficient. Service levels are lower. But we can maintain this, and we can control expenses, and we can deliver you a balanced budget every year without a new revenue source. So I want that message to be really clear. But there's a lot of needs that we've identified and council members have identified that continue to be out there, and we don't see a way of starting to deal with those needs unless we look at some new revenue source. And so that's kind of the message today. We don't think that the recovery is going to be such that you could count on revenues going up at 6 or 7% and controlling expenses at 3 or 4% and generating a big, you know, surplus there that you could then put toward. You may, that may be a strategy you want to use, but especially with the cuts we've already made, we think that would be difficult. So the council may want to consider a new revenue source, and just a few things that we've identified. One, we continue to hear a desire in the community to restore and enhance services. In fact, one of my big fears is everybody's coming to and say, oh, you're in good financial shape. Can you do this? Can you do that? And we're getting a lot of that. There's a huge unfunded liability for current and future capital needs, and then the loss of the RDA funding, which was going to happen anyway, but it's happened 3 years earlier. So I'm going to go through a little of these in a little more detail. First, an issue that we hear a lot from council and also from the business community is the desire to add additional police officers, not because we have rampant crime in the community, but on the quality of life issues, that transient issues. Some of the success we've had now with the restoration of the beat coordinator is about can we become more community-oriented, but trying to deal with those quality of life issues, noise issues in the downtown. In the Parks and Recreation area, we did a lot of cuts over the last few years in both in recreation programming and also in park maintenance. And so a desire, can we start restoring that back? Can we put back the integrated pest management program? Can we get ahead of the curve on many of the maintenance issues? And then can we restore a lot of the services that we provided to the community, especially the free services that we used to provide that we just can't afford? Library services, the same thing. The council did last year restore Monday services, but I'm sure that Irene can tell you, especially in the book budget and some of the other services, the desire to bring back additional services there. And then just deferred maintenance generally. And just drive around the community and you'll see where I'm not real proud of some of the maintenance that we're doing. In terms of unfunded capital projects, last week the council saw the 6-year capital improvement program. In that program, as you saw, we identified about $600 million. Of those, funded is $200 million. And I do caution, although we talk about a $400 million funding gap, it's probably less than that because, as we talked about, if we don't have grants in hand, we don't call that funded. But I can assure you that we're not going to get grants or other sources of money to fill that whole gap. So let's just say it's $250 million or $200 million instead of $400 million. It's still a huge gap. And so trying to define exactly what it is probably just more of an academic exercise. The reality is we've got a large infrastructure gap, and it's getting larger. And this is not unique to us. Today, if you looked at the news press and the opinion section, there was a big column on when is the country going to deal with the national infrastructure problem. So we're not unique here. In fact, I would probably say we're probably in better shape than many communities, but we still have a terrible gap. And if we wait for the feds and the state to solve the problem, it's going to get a heck of a lot worse before it gets better. And because we're a visitor community and because we count on tourism, we also, I think, have a need to invest back in the infrastructure to keep our own reputation up and to help our major industry, which is tourism. Examples of unfunded projects, and again, this is just out of the infrastructure report, is the streets capital, which is $200 million. And again, some of that may get funded, but you just drive around the community and look at the streets. We have a good slurry seal program. We have a good preventative maintenance program. But in many cases, our streets are getting to that 30, 40, 50-year life when another patch of slurry seal is not going to be enough to repair the streets the way they need to be repaired. And so we're getting to a critical point. The Station 7 rebuild, it's probably $5 to $7 million. That's the station that's up in the Riviera. It's over 50 years old. Our goal is at some point to have a joint station with the U.S. Forest Service, but that's probably our most critical need in terms of fire stations. A huge need is the police station, which has been a topic since for the last 20 years. We think it's around $55 million. The Cabrillo bathhouse renovation is in the range of $10 million. Ortega Pool is going to need to be renovated in that 6-year period, $6 million. minor thing, City Hall elevator. We still have, for ADA access, if you need to go to the personnel department, you got to go around to the back and come through the old police entrance, things like that, that at some point we're going to need to deal with. But just examples of some of the projects that we have no source of funding for now. As you know, we talked about this problem back 5 years ago. The council appointed an infrastructure financing task force. I see Mr. Jensen here, who was on that task force at the time. And they spent about 6 months looking at this. Their recommendations were, and I found this first one interesting, that we should devote 10% of general fund revenues should be devoted to infrastructure investment by fiscal year 2012, which was right kind of when the recession hit. Well, we have cut the general fund by about 10%, just basically to deal with the recession. So we've taken a lot of that excess that they felt we could get, we've had to do anyway just to deal with the recession. And I'm not sure you could take the next 10% out without having really, really serious impacts. But I just found that was kind of interesting. They talked about us fully funding the city services facilities renewal program at $2.1 million. We're actually slowly creeping up on that. I think we're at about $1.5. That's that internal program we have to replace HVAC equipment, replace carpeting, roofs. It doesn't build you new buildings, but at least keeps the buildings somewhat current. They recommended that we consider a half-cent sales tax. They also suggested that at some point the city consider general obligation bonds to fund critical infrastructure. And we'll talk about how these revenues work in a little bit. Don't want to forget the loss of the RDA. And I was surprised when we calculated these numbers up that it was greater than I had thought. But as you know, the RDA was eliminated by the state. The final elimination was January 31st, 2012. Our RDA was scheduled to go until 2015. So the loss of the capital money from that elimination 3 years early is between $44.7 and $55.6 million. And the difference is that bond money, the $10 million of bond money that we're still holding, that we may be able to use if we get this safe harbor status. So that's the variation. If we don't get it, then the loss is 55.6. So we discounted out the debt service. We discounted out what had to go to affordable housing. And this is what's left that we would have had between the money we already had in the bank and then the 3 years of tax increment that we lost because of the elimination of the RDA. So it's actually a bigger number than I was aware of. And key impacts were projects that we had identified that would be at least partially funded through that. Was the police building, the Cabrillo Arts Pavilion, a lot of downtown improvements that we identified, especially in neighborhoods in terms of lighting, sidewalk, and landscaping that we were working on, and we're, in many cases we were in design.
Madam Mayor.
Go ahead.
Yeah.
Mr. Armstrong, you used the expression safe harbor, and I heard Mr. Casey use it yesterday. Would you give us a brief description of what that means? Maybe you have, and I went over my head.
The way the state law that affects the dissolution of RDAs works is once you pay your payment that you're required to make to the county, which then gets distributed out to the taxing agencies, and you file a property management plan with first with the oversight board and it's approved by the state, then it basically means you followed all the state rules. Then you get this safe harbor status through the state. And then that the state law says that then the oversight board can approve the use of any bond monies that you have for their intended purpose. So whatever the bonds were originally sold for, you can then use them for that purpose. And so we've made our payment. I believe we made the payment to the county now of how much did we send them? $19 million?
By the end of this month, $19
million. We'll send $19 million to the county, which they will then distribute out to the taxing agencies. We're working on the property management plan. We hope to have that done in the next 3 months or so. That'll be filed with the oversight board, and then it'll go to the state. And then we'll know if we'll be able to use that. I think we feel pretty good that we will.
Thank you.
Is it a zero-sum game? Like, is it all $10 million or nothing? Or is it partial money for certain projects? Or do we not know that?
I think it will come down to the Oversight Board approving that it was for the intended purpose, which in our bond covenants were relatively general about how we were going to use that money. So I think we'll be able to convince them of that.
Okay. Yes, Randy.
Mr. Armstrong, is the 44.7556 of capital funds net of our portion of the return of the sales tax money? Or that the property tax money?
Yeah.
Bob, I think it is. Yeah.
It is. So that considers what we have actually, the portion of the RDA we've gotten back as part of the taxing agency distribution.
And most of the money we're getting back, other than that little one-time chunk that we talked about yesterday, pretty much is a net because we already had overhead expenses and other expenses that the city's now had to absorb. So there's not a lot of new property tax money that's available out of it.
Thank you.
Go ahead.
I appreciate hearing the comparison of our increased revenues in the last, let's say, 3-4 years, whenever we came out of the bottom, and the increase in PERS costs. How do those two numbers relate to one another?
You want to help me out there, Bob?
Yeah, I think that with the rising in taxes in the last few years, revenues, it's coincided with the increases in our PERS rates. When the economy tanked in 2008 and 2009, immediately we started seeing increases to our PERS rates. So I think a lot of those additional revenues have been consumed by the fact that our PERS rates have gone up. So it's almost been coincidental.
So those are about the same?
Yeah, I can't tell you what those numbers look like. But
I'd appreciate hearing
sure.
And I think we could probably provide you a chart that would show what we've paid to PERS over the last 7 or 8 years, and then what's happened to our revenues. And I think that would show what you want.
Yeah. Great.
And what I think you would find is because we reached the employee concessions for 2 or 3 years, that the slope kind of leveled off, and now that those concessions are going away, unless we're able to continue them, that it's going to continue to go up.
Great. Thank you.
Madam Mayor.
Yes, go ahead.
I think what Mr. White's asking, if I may interpret, is PERS going to bust the budget? That'd be a fair way of saying it.
Well, it's a worry. I mean, just PERS is a big
what
expense.
I think that PERS is going to do is the PERS rates, unless we're able to get some substantial concessions, is it will absorb most of the revenue increase that you have, or a lot of it, so that it won't be available for service enhancements or for infrastructure. It's not going to bust the budget. We'll deal with it. But it's clearly, you know, it's a cost that's rising. It's not going flat or going down.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
This is just to stimulate your interest, but let's just say that we were able to generate an additional $10 million a year. You know, when I talk with staff, how would we recommend you spend it? And we would probably recommend about $1 million for enhancements in park and recreation and library services. Another $1 million in police officers, park rangers, restorative policing, again, those quality of life issues. Debt service to build a new police station, if we borrowed against part of that revenue stream, would be about $4 million. I put downtown preservation $1 million. This is the concern that we have, that with RDA going away and all of the hardscape and landscaping and aesthetic improvements that the RDA paid for downtown, we need to start planning for maintaining those at a higher level and eventually replacing, you know, brick sidewalks when they go, and the crosswalks. Not sure exactly the painting of streetlights. All of those enhancements that we have on State Street that are very expensive to maintain, but somehow to keep, you know, have a source of doing that, because we're just not going to be able to afford to maintain that the way we need to maintain it is our vital business area. And again, this is just brainstorming. And then other critical infrastructure, $3 million. And again, this is just, if you said, hey, how would you spend it, this would be our first cut at it. And obviously, we didn't spend a lot of time on this, but just a feel for it and how you spread it and benefit the organization. The other thing that if we were to choose a new revenue source, my recommendation is, you know, a concern I've heard from a lot of people is, you're just going to use that to pay people more, or cover the PERS rates, is that somehow you have to segregate the money, put it someplace that there's accountability to the voters. And so we would recommend something, and I've talked with the city attorney about this, of that we could do this, even if it's a general tax, you could still create a special fund. I'm calling it the Community Enhancement Fund, where you could put those monies in, you could appropriate them separately, you could have an accountability, you could show the community, similar to what we do with Measure B, the Creeks funds, and it would allow the community to know, no, those things are going to enhance benefits, not just getting sucked into the bureaucracy. So it's something to think about. You could do this through a couple ways. One, if you put a ballot initiative on, you could have a second measure that says that, you know, should we set this up? The other is you could structure it that way from the beginning, and you can say that, you know, if we get this, we're going to put it in this fund. You could do it by ordinance. Now, again, you know, a future council could dissolve that, but I think if it's set up and it's done in an appropriate way, it's a way to kind of discipline ourselves to make sure that that money is used the way that, you know, we're trying to tell the voters, if you choose to do this, that it's going to be spent. And we think you could do that in such a way where you could still do it with a general tax rather than a specific tax. And obviously we'd have...
The difference between that is a 50% plus one majority vote versus a two-thirds majority vote.
Mm-hmm. And I think if nothing else, it's also just good management if you were going to do that. It does force that discipline on us. And require that you look at it more carefully than if you just put it in the general fund and it got blended in after 3 or 4 years, you'd lose that accountability. So I'm going to turn it over to Mr. Samario, the finance director, to talk about potential revenue options, what the voter thresholds are, and then after that, Mr. Casey's going to talk about what's going on in the state and in the region.
Before you get there, what you just mentioned, that sounds similar to what the city of Santa Maria did last spring. I mean, they did a quarter cent sales tax at a 50% plus one, but everyone kind of knew it was to staff their new fire station and for public safety, although it wasn't designated a public safety initiative. So it was a similar kind of process, it sounds like. Is that?
Yeah, and I think we would suggest that even if you don't identify them super specifically, that you do identify to the community, here's what that money would go for, and then you put the money in a special fund, and then you're very public process on how you allocate that money out. I think in Santa Maria, because they had received a grant for a new fire station and they didn't have the money to staff it, that was kind of a natural, at least that staffing of that fire station. And then as I recall, they identified additional police officers that they were going to spend the money on.
Go ahead.
Right, thank you, Madam Mayor, members of council. So I'm going to be talking about revenue options, and clearly we're talking about increases to our existing taxes, so we're going to talk about each one of them that are candidates. Some obviously are a little more practical than others to raise, as we'll see. And I wanted to start by talking about sales taxes, and a lot of people don't really know how current sales taxes are allocated. Our current tax rate here in the county of Santa Barbara is 8%. If you were to ask people around the area what they knew what the tax rate was, a lot of people would say, I don't know what it is. It changes often. It's currently 8%. It just went up in January by 0.25%. That was the governor's proposal and initiative that was passed by the California voters to increase it by quarter point for the next 4 years. And so you can see most of the money, or most of that 8%, goes to the state's general fund, 5.25 cents. Cities and counties only get 1 cent. That's the Bradley Burns portion. That's the amount that local governments are entitled to get. There are some portions that the city also get. As you know, to the far right, we get a half cent sales tax for Measure A. We also get at the top a half a cent that goes for public safety. This was sort of a give back by the state when they took a lot of our money away in the mid-90s through the first ERAF shift.
On the Prop 172, about 95% of that goes to the county, and we get about 5% of the half cent. So we get about... what, $300,000 a year of that?
Sure.
And in Santa Maria, the tax rate's 8.25% in the city, because they have the extra 0.25%.
That's correct. So, as I mentioned, the sales taxes that we get is 1%, and it's, as you know, it's applied to the sale of tangible personal property, and it's based on what's called point of sale or situs. So wherever that transaction occurred is where how the allocation is determined. If we were to increase our taxes or sales taxes by a quarter or a half a percent, it would be applied differently or calculated differently. It's based on delivery versus point of sale. From a practical perspective, it's essentially the same. Where it might be different, for example, is if somebody came to Santa Barbara or lived in Santa Barbara I'm sorry, came to Santa Barbara, bought some furniture, and had to deliver to Carpinteria. Because the delivery point was Carpinteria, there would be no district tax or the half-cent sales tax, in our example, would not be applied. So it's delivery. I'm not sure how much we would lose, but my understanding is, in talking to our consultants, there would be some leakage because of that distinction. There's also a portion of our sales tax that we get each year that's based on where out-of-state businesses conduct transactions here in the county. So if you live in the county of Santa Barbara and you buy something from a company that's in Nevada, that sales taxes, to the extent they're collected, get pooled within the county, and then they're allocated in proportion to the sales taxes in that county. For example, Santa Barbara, we get about 38% of all the taxes that are pooled in the county because we are the highest generator of sales taxes. If we were to raise taxes, we would no longer be have that sort of that pooled amount. We'd only get the portion for the that's based on delivery transactions that took place here in Santa Barbara. So you would have to back out from the gross those pooled revenues we get. So today we get about $20 million in sales taxes. We'd have to back out about 2.3 that comes from the pool. And if we were to raise then our sales taxes by half a cent, we would get half of that $18 million, for example. So it's not quite $10 million we'd get. It'd be closer to about $9 million. That's our estimate at this point. Some people think you just raise it by half a cent, you're going to get 50% of what you're getting now, and it's not quite that much. That's what I'm trying to say here.
Madam Mayor? So we lose $2 million in pooled money.
Yeah.
What happens to that?
We wouldn't lose it. That would still be part of the base that we get, but by adding a half a cent or a quarter cent, we wouldn't get that pooled, wouldn't apply to that additional amount. We wouldn't have those kinds of transactions being applied to this half cent or quarter cent sales tax. It wouldn't, just wouldn't apply.
I see.
So our bed tax, as you know, is 12% currently. 2% goes into our creeks restoration and water quality improvement fund pursuant to Measure B passed in 2001. 10% goes to the general fund. For next year, we're projecting about $16.2 million. And so that means every 1% represents about $1.6 million, at least in the first year. Of course, that would grow every year. So in order to achieve and sort of this benchmark of $10 million per year, we'd need to raise our bed taxes by 6.25. And as we'll see, that's in comparison to other agencies that Paul will go into, that's pretty impractical. We also have a utility users tax that's 6% currently for water, refuse, natural gas, and electricity. For telecommunication services, it's 5.75%. Our projection for next year, $14 million. And as you know, half of that currently goes into our streets fund. But if we were to raise it 1%, we'd get in total $1.4 million. And in order to achieve the $10 million we're talking about, we'd have to increase it by greater than or more than 7%. We also have a business license tax, and that rate varies by type of business and their size. We only get about $2.3 million per year currently, or at least for next year. So obviously, in order to generate anything close to what we might need, we'd have to raise them substantially. And then general obligation bonds. This is one other option. Rather than raising revenues to provide ongoing revenue sources, one option is for us to sell or issue general obligation bonds. They are would be for a specific purpose, and it's one-time proceeds for example, a police building or other capital improvements we want to include. We would have to raise property taxes in order to achieve that, to cover the debt service. And by definition, because it's a special tax or because it's for a specific purpose, it would require a two-thirds voter approval or support versus a 50%. But this is one option to provide sort of a one-time infusion of money, capital money, for some needed projects. So the voter thresholds for a general tax, as we've talked about already, majority approval, so 50% plus one. And as Jim indicated, it could be accompanied by an advisory measure, so that indicate what the community's interest would be and how those funds were used, but not binding. And it can apply to any of these taxes we've talked about. So we can do a special tax as well, and we talked about this two-thirds vote. It's really not what the top of the tax is. It's been how, but it's how it's used. So if it's for general purposes, it's 50% plus one. If it's for a specific purpose, it's two-thirds. And so I mentioned this already, general obligation bonds. Two-thirds vote required. Any questions on any of that?
I'm going to talk just briefly about comparative election results, just to give you a sense statewide about what's going on with other jurisdictions as they look at revenue measures. You're certainly not alone in considering revenue measures. And then I'll talk a little bit. You can go to the next slide, Bob. And then I'll talk about comparative sales tax and TOT rates compared to our region, and also some comparative in cities that we often kind of judge ourselves against, and then timing considerations, just to kind of wrap up, and then Mr. Armstrong will finish there. So going to go through a few election years. I'll spend a little bit more on this most recent one, November 2012. There were 28 general tax majority vote measures in the state of California. 25 of them passed. So close to 80% of those measures passed on the general tax. You'll notice below there were a fewer amount of special tax, two-thirds tax measures, and that was a little below 50%. So the trend statewide is that the general tax measures were more successful with the voters. Here are some examples in more detail of the different measures. It's a little small, but up top, again, it kind of shows the general sales tax measure votes was the most common measures put before the voters by other cities. The hotel tax votes down below were also quite successful, over 70%, but not quite as many. You'll see parcel tax votes, the two-third vote requirement, less than 50% passed. We showed that on the previous slide. And then the other items I think are more miscellaneous. The utility tax vote, that's like the cleanup legislation that we did a couple years ago that a number of jurisdictions are getting around to, and some other kind of smaller. You'll see just a few general obligation bond, two-thirds votes came in at less than 50% as well. So I think the takeaway from this slide is that most people look towards sales tax measures and the hotel tax, bed tax measures, and to a lesser extent, the parcel tax. And I'd say a lot of the parcel taxes were for special districts and others where parcel tax is kind of their the revenue option that they have more available to them, like a library district or a fire district or something. They don't have the ability to go after sales tax. And so I think that's where a lot of those parcel taxes come from. And schools, exactly. Although these are just city measures. I'm not getting into the education measures. I kept that separately. By the way, all this information came from Michael Coleman, who's a consultant to the California League of Cities. It's on a website, californiacityfinance.com. All my charts on the election results came from there. It's public information, and I'm just kind of using some selective to kind of give you a general idea. If you want all the details of all the measures, it's available on that website. So just some examples. I just kind of pulled some city examples to give you a taste of the types of communities that are going that you might be familiar with, and also how they did it. For example, Albany, up in the Bay Area, they went for a half-cent sales tax rate, and then you'll notice that a lot of jurisdictions either had a sunset clause or did not. I would say more had sunset clauses than didn't, but for instance, Albany does not have a sunset clause. They got close to 80% voter approval for that. Culver City, as an example, also went for a half cent, but they had a 10-year sunset clause, and they got 76%. You can see Carmel went for a 1-cent tax increase and got that approved for 10 years with over 75% support. Paso Robles, a little more locally, went for a half cent for 12 years, also passed. They did an advisory measure. So not everyone is doing advisory measures. Say most are not doing the compatible advisory measure, but Paso Robles did, and you'll see that the advisory measure passed with 71%, then the actual sales tax measure passed with 59%.
And the advisory measure is to say, well, we'd like it used for this.
Correct. And I think politically, a council's determination in that is that an advisory measure kind of carries more weight because it's the voice of the people guiding you about how to spend that money, and that would hopefully be more of a moral binding for future councils to kind of respect that advisory measure. Then on the hotel transient occupancy tax measures, similar rate. Again, passage quite strong in November 2012, Santa Cruz, Carpinteria. We had a lot of local jurisdictions that kind of came up to our 12% rate. The takeaway I would take here is look at the rate information. You can see that most people who went for bed tax measures were going up to 11 or 12%. And as you know, we're currently at 12%. Garden Grove, I would just point out, went up to 14.5%, right next to Disneyland. So they were a little more aggressive and went up to 14.5%. Santa Monica is already at 14%. So you see some of the real tourist destination communities are a little more aggressive on their bed tax, but predominantly I would say the trend is towards the 10 to 12% range on bed tax. November 2011, now I just want to go back a few other years just to kind of give you different economic climates and political climates just to kind of see if there are any interesting trends. November 2011, 86% of the measures passed on the general majority tax. The two-thirds measures were quite successful in November 2011, 69%. And one of the things to be thinking about is turnout in election years. This last November that we just went through was a presidential election, large turnout. November 2011, an off year, generally lower turnout. That's when we have our elections, though, and so that'll be part of your consideration if you choose to look at something about which election time frame to go for. November 2010, not a presidential year, but a governor race year, and so you have more statewide measures and elections going on. The general tax measures passed at 63%. I'd say this was more right in the middle of the very difficult economic times. The special tax measures, again, kind of dipped below the 50% success rate. Some just pulled some examples from November 2010. Again, you can see the differences of who went for sunset clauses and who didn't, South El Monte. Santa Monica did an advisory measure. They split their half-cent sales tax with the school district, got 61% vote on that. Santa Barbara County was one of the ones that did not pass, and I think we're pretty familiar with that. I think that was going for the North County jail issue and was not successful. And then just going back to November 2006, I wanted to go pre-economic crisis time just to kind of see where things were in November 2006. Again, close to 70% passage on the majority vote measures, just at 50% for the two-thirds vote measures. Now, the next slide, we had a lot of kind of regional cities that were on this section. So you can see the Morro Bay, San Luis, Santa Cruz, Grover Beach, all went for half cent. They kind of went together. It was kind of a countywide approach. And they said, let's kind of go as one so as not to create any appearance of economic competitive disadvantage with the sunset clause of 2015. And they all passed up there. Arroyo Grande was the only one who then did advisory measures, and they did a whole series of advisory measures. They said, hey, what do you think about transportation? 70%. What do you think about streets? 68%. What do you think about police fire? 59%. What do you think about accessibility upgrades at City Hall? Ooh, 41%. So
there goes the elevator.
Exactly. And then Sacramento County had a quarter cent sales tax that only got 20% success. That was a tough one. All right, comparative sales tax rates. Bob already stole my thunder. Bob's been quizzing everyone the last couple days. Do you know what your local sales tax rate is? And he was surprised how many people could not, off the top of their head, know what the local sales tax rate. And part of that is that it's been fluctuating for the last couple years. It's really gone up and down. The state had a half-cent add-on that had us up to about 8.25%. And then it dropped down to 7.75% when it expired, and then it recently went back up to 8% with the addition of that quarter cent sales tax. So it's jumped around a little bit. But Central Coast cities, you can see we're in the red. We're at 8%, consistent with Carpinteria, Goleta, Oxnard. Santa Maria is the one that bumps up to the 8.25% because of that add-on they did. Ventura and Camarillo are down at 7.5% because Ventura County has not done a countywide sales tax measure for transportation purposes. And so that's where you see some county by county differences in that regard. Comparative cities, this is what we've done, the comparative indicators, where we've chosen similar type cities throughout California. Where do we rate? And again, I would say the takeaway from this is that a lot of these differentiate about the countywide sales tax measures and then some additional city measures. We're right there in the middle, Santa Barbara. Similar at 8% is Oceanside, Newport Beach, Huntington Beach, and Carlsbad. The lowest would be Ventura, as I just mentioned. But then higher than us would be Sunnyvale, Santa Cruz, Berkeley, Redondo Beach, and then Santa Monica is at the highest at 9.5%. And so that's some countywide measures plus their additional measure that they put on locally. Sales tax revenue per capita. We just kind of wanted to we've shown this to you before. Oftentimes we think of ourselves, and I think people perceive Santa Barbara as being a very wealthy city because we must have a big sales tax base and we must be very wealthy. And in reality, we're pretty modest in the middle. And if you think about it, and the easiest one to compare to is Santa Monica, which is at $500 per capita. We're at about $224 per capita. And we always think of ourselves, oh, we're very similar to Santa Monica. But if you really go through Santa Monica and look at their commercial base, they have such a higher commercial base than we do. I think we need to remember that we're a slow growth community that has really kept the scale low, and that reflects on our sales tax per capita rates as well. So we're really pretty much right in the median when you compare to those same cities as before, Sunnyvale, Ventura, Santa Cruz, Newport Beach, as examples. Same thing on the transient occupancy tax rates for Central Coast cities. As I mentioned before, we're on the high end with our comparative cities. People kind of caught up in this last election. When you go to Ventura, Santa Maria, San Luis Obispo, they're at the 10% rate, a little bit lower than we are. Camarillo is actually down at 9%. When you look at the comparative cities, we're again on the higher end, with Santa Monica being the exception at being up at 14% on the high end. Otherwise, people are either at the 10% or 12% rate. And on the revenue per capita, we do okay on the bed taxes. Mr. Armstrong said we're a tourist-based economy in many regards, and so we do have a number of hotel rooms for a city of our size. And so you can see our per capita is only less than Newport Beach and Santa Monica, but higher than Carlsbad, Santa Cruz, Sunnyvale, Redondo Beach as you kind of go back down.
Yeah, Mr. Casey, I had kind of a question on our juxtaposition with Carlsbad. It has the same rate as we do, and quite a significant jump in per capita sales tax, but then down in the bed tax. Is that because of the concentration of automobile dealerships in Carlsbad?
That very well could be. I don't know the details specific, and we could look at that. But that automobile is one of the largest local revenue-generating sales tax.
Well, they have substantial automobile row there. It's kind of like the one down in Ventura.
They also have Legoland. I don't know how much Legoland might spin off in sales tax. But
also big box stores.
Yep, we don't have big box.
Thank you.
So, election timing considerations, just some thoughts for your consideration if you were to look at pursuing something. November 2013 comes up really quick, and so if you're thinking of November 2013, you need to move pretty quickly. You'd need to make your decisions and place a measure on the ballot by July, so it's just a few months out. It's a city-focused election, and I think that could be considered good or bad. It's good because the local voters are engaged in the local politics and the local issues. At the same time, a number of you are running for re-election. You have other council candidates, and is it hard to kind of mix these two together? That's just a consideration for you all to think about. There is no national or statewide election, so turnout tends to be smaller on an odd November election ballot. It requires a majority council vote. When we have a city election, to place a measure on a city ballot during a city election year, it requires 4 out of 7 of you to place it on the measure. I don't think we would strongly recommend going forward with just a bare majority for a sales tax measure or some other measure. We think it needs kind of broader support, but that option is available to you if you go during a city election year, which is every 2 years on the odd number Novembers.
That's generally true, except for sales tax measures, which require 2/3 vote, council approval.
A sale of general fund sales tax measure requires 2/3.
Any sales tax increase requires a 2/3 supermajority approval.
He should be on mic.
The game.
Okay, so for the camera, so a. Sales tax measure to put on any ballot would require a 5-vote majority.
That's by state law and revenue taxation.
Okay. Can we also, we know up here because through Measure G and others, but there's putting something on the ballot and then there's actually running an election, which the city can do one and not the other. I mean just sort of the, and I don't know if you're going to bring up what the city's role is in. If something were to go on the ballot, you know, in terms of education versus advocacy and that kind of thing, because that also shapes in terms of what we decide as a body to do and what that means out in the general public when something's put on a ballot.
Yeah, we weren't going to spend too much time on that.
But we
But we can, exactly. So let me finish, and then we can answer questions on that and talk about that. But you're right. Once a measure is placed on the ballot, the city organization can only provide factual education information. It cannot play an advocacy role. That requires elected officials or private citizens to run the campaign side, and we have to be hands-off at that point once the measure gets placed on the ballot.
Bendy, you had a question.
Yeah. You in the latter bullet there, you mentioned turnout. How does the city turnout in the off years compare to the city turnout in the present national years?
If you can, Mr. Lissette, if you can come
microphone.
To the mic, please.
The others, but in 2007 we had a 37.5 voter turnout. In 2009 it was nearly 50%, and in 2011 it was 41.26. Now in the general, in the statewide elections, they tend to be a little bit higher in certain areas, but that's our story right now, and it was a very good turnout. For example, in 2009, nearly 50%.
Thank you.
And then just the last slide.
Is that your question? I'm sorry.
Well, and then but I just thought, clearly we don't want to have an election where fewer people participate. And I had thought that the local, that the city elections were doing better such that there's a bona fide representation there. So that was what I was looking for, was that comparison of this cycle versus the national and state cycles.
A lot of these elections, as you know, the turnout is issued. Statewide elections. On the flip side, you have less attention to the particular issues because they're mixed with a variety of other issues. So while you may gain on one side greater participation, you may lose on the other where you have less emphasis on the particular issue. Sure. Obviously, in a citywide election, that's, you know, you have the council, mayor elections, and a particular ballot measure. So there's a lot of emphasis. And that's part of the argument that actually council had when you were looking at the issue of switching from an odd to an even election. So a lot of the same arguments come back in the discussion.
Thank you.
And then if you went, next slide, Bob, if you went to November 14, you can place the measure on the November 14 ballot anytime you want. You don't have to wait until July of 2014 to put the measure on. Generally a larger turnout, as we talked about. It allows more time for organizing discussion and community dialogue and setting things up. It may compete with other local measures. We don't know who might be on the ballot, but you're already hearing rumblings that maybe City College might be looking, or even the school district might be looking to go to the voters for another measure. So that's just a consideration. And it requires a unanimous council vote to go on a non-city election. And that applies even for the sales tax. I think that's our charter issue that dictates that. So if you want
Prop 218.
Prop 218. So November of 2014, if you go for an even number year, it requires a unanimous vote of the city council to place it on the ballot. So that's just a consideration as well.
How about legal questions? Steve, could you come up to the mic? So two questions about this unanimous vote. One is, how many times do you need a unanimous vote? If we were to decide today, which we're not going to vote today, but if all seven of us were here, it has to be a 7-0. It can't be a 6-0 and one absent first. Is that correct? I think. Yeah.
It does say unanimous.
Okay.
And yeah.
So if we were to decide today, let's do something next year, but we have to actually do the language and the ordinance and put it on, you know, and vote to consolidate the election with the county, and that doesn't happen until sometime in 2014. Do you still need a 7-0 vote at that vote in order to continue moving it onto the ballot? You see what I'm saying?
Yes. I believe this issue, it hasn't been decided by the courts, and Prop 218 isn't altogether clear. It just says that it must be unanimous vote of the legislative body to call, excuse me, to place a tax measure on anything other than the general election date. So in November of 2014 would be something other than our general election date. And I think the answer is that you need something official, either a council resolution or a council ordinance that's unanimous to place it on the ballot.
And then is that 7-0 vote needed again when the vote comes
next summer, for or next June in 2014, because you have to vote to consolidate with the county and put the actual item and the language and, you know, all those technical things. Is that also a 7-0 vote?
I don't believe so. In other words, okay. I believe there's no legal reason why you couldn't place something on the November 2014 ballot next month, okay, as a council. But you would, yeah, do that by resolution or by ordinance, and at that point you're past that Prop 218 requirement, and I don't really think it can be undone.
So here's I'm just looking at the situation of this council. There's definitely going to be one new person in 2014. We have term limits in the city. Council member's house seat is up. So somebody other than council member house will be on the council in 2014. We have no idea who that person is, and we have no idea what his or her views are on something like this. Let's say seven of us this year decides to put something on in 2014. Could that one new person undo what this council this year did?
I don't believe so.
No, okay. So, and then my final question is, when we did Measure G, I think it was back in 2008, that was the utility users tax, we had a 7-0 vote. We had a 7-0 vote, obviously, it went on the ballot. We also had to declare a fiscal emergency in order to do it.
Yeah.
And so is that part of the Prop 218 requirements in order to do a revenue enhancement stream in 2014?
Right. It's all, actually, I think it's all even in the same sentence of Prop 218, although I don't believe they use the word fiscal emergency. They just, as an emergency, declare an emergency. And then 218 did not define that, and it really hasn't been defined. So it's, if a council says that it's an emergency and takes a unanimous action, you've satisfied that requirement.
So if we were to put something on in 2014 and make that do that resolution this year, we would have to declare some form of emergency in order to put it on for next year.
That's correct.
Okay.
But let me add, I think most municipal lawyers would say a legislative action like that is not justiciable. In other words, if this is your question, could someone go to court and say, oh, it's not really an emergency? I think my answer would be, no, they really couldn't. That's a legislative determination. And generally, judges aren't given the authority to undo legislative determinations.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you. I appreciate that clarification. You had a question?
No, it's a good question.
Yeah. I'm sorry. You have a few more slides, and then we'll have questions, and then we'll have public comment.
Oh, sorry. Go back real quick, Bob. Just if there was any interest to do polling, just to let you know, the cost to run a poll of surveying 300 people by telephone is about $25,000, give or take. I talked to a couple of reputable polling firms who do a lot of municipal polling statewide and just kind of got a general idea. Spanish survey could be done as well. It adds some cost, but it's modest, and so that could be done as well. And if there was a desire to quickly do a poll to get more information before deciding how to go forward, turnaround could be as quick as 30 days, and so it's something to be done. And then just so you know, if the city pays for the poll, it's a public information document. If a private entity pays for a poll and does their analysis, it's not public information because we don't have access to it. But just let you know that on polling.
You can only do polling to determine if there's an interest in the community. So once you decide to put something on the ballot, then you can't do any polling because then it would be viewed as a part of electioneering. So it would have to be done as a part of your process to determine information if there's sufficient interest to then put it on the ballot. So last slide we have is just possible council options, and we talked about most of these. You know, one is to assess community support through polling and decide after that. You could defer a decision and say, you know what, this just isn't the right time. Let's wait till the economy gets better. Obviously, we've talked about both November 2013, 2014. Or you could just say, we don't want to decide right now or take no action. Say, let's just hold off. So these are just kind of the options that we felt. And again, I think for us as a staff, you know, again, this is not because we're facing a fiscal crisis, but we've identified this need. We think we need to start dealing with it. It's not a new need. The Infrastructure Financing Task Force talked about this 5 years ago now. And the problem is not going to go away. And at some point, I think we need to start dealing with it. But again, it's up to the council.
Thank you. Questions first, and then we'll go to public comment. Any questions?
I have questions.
Go ahead.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Thank you for your presentation today. A general obligation bond, you say, is a two-thirds? And is that what the police station, the city tried to go for money to rebuild a police station? Was it 1999 or 2000? And I'm trying to think who's here that has the institutional memory of why that failed. And can we learn something from that today?
You know, it was back in 1999. It was a general obligation bond. It did fail. It failed by a decent amount. As to why, I think you can get 10 different answers if you talk to different people. I think from our perspective, there wasn't a really well-run private campaign supporting the measure. I think there was some neighborhood opposition about the scope and size of the project that hadn't been vetted a lot prior to the measure going on the ballot. So there was concern about it going too close to the Laguna neighborhood and being too large. So I think you just had a lot of that. I think you had some feeling at the time that the community supported the police but didn't feel they needed a new building. And so just a lot of different dynamics, I think, went into why that didn't pass.
And then the task force, Mr. Wiley?
I was going to reiterate what Paul said. I was here, and I think it's an important, it's actually something that is important to think about now. My impression was that the city felt it wasn't able to adequately explain the need for the measure, and it had to do with the legal constraint that we not conduct electioneering. And I bring it up now because actually the law has progressed a lot since then, and it appears to be much better for cities. There was a California Supreme Court decision a few years ago out of Salinas over this issue and a library measure they had. And the courts now and even some statutes are more clear that cities can provide informational materials. It's not supposed to be advocacy, but it can be informational, and it can involve using city staff and to some extent existing city resources. I really wouldn't suggest you spend money on this sort of thing, but the law is better in this area in allowing cities and counties to explain the need for an election measure now. And I didn't see that happen back when we did the police building. We just, you know, thought people would understand. And, you know, we had a few years before that, we tried to do a general obligation bond to purchase the Wilcox property. And I think it got like 65% approval, and it needed 66 and two-thirds. But again, if we had been able to explain ourselves or felt able to explain ourselves a little better, that probably would have passed.
Well, the police building is such a big concern and a big ticket item. My goodness, it's really breathtaking. My second question would be about the task force. Was that a year-long process? And I did read the report, but maybe it would be good for the public to hear. And it was different kinds of stakeholders who looked at it was capital. The focus was on capital needs. Is that right?
You know, what had happened is we provided the council with the six-year capital improvement program like you received last week, and we identified the large unfunded liability. And at that point, I recommended that the council needed to deal with the issue and get input. And so the council appointed a blue ribbon committee-type group of, you know, local community members, business folks, and others to look at how can we potentially deal with that need. And I think they spent about 8 or 9 months meeting with staff, digging in. They did a really thorough job, and then came and gave a report to the city council. And that was in, as I recall, spring of 2008, right when the economy was starting to crash.
And they not only looked at the infrastructure needs and the deficit and toured facilities and got a better handle, they really did an intensive analysis of the city's finances as well. And that's where they kind of came up with some of those financial recommendations where they felt you could go.
I see Mr. Jensen here. I don't know. Mr. Jensen, if you were chair of the Infrastructure Task Force, I don't know if you want to add anything at this point, your experiences. And there were how many people on the task force?
It was seven.
I think there were eight of us on the task force. And they ranged from real estate people, Ms. Grubb, and construction people, Frank Skipper, consultants, someone like Dudley Morris. There were a couple, a biotech fellow, Mr. Kirshner, I think, and Scott Burns, who was both a recreation person and a harbor person. He was much stressed because we kept hammering on the harbor paying a better share of its expenses. I don't know whether that's happened yet or not, but so the thing we looked at was all the possible sources, and then even RDA was an available source. And now that's gone away. So it would be interesting to know what we'd recommend now. But we thought the city did a very good job of understanding its needs and of satisfying many of them. But that when it was all said and done, simply doing it in the routine business wasn't sufficient. And it would be something we ought to take another step to make sure we satisfied our obligations as stewards of the property. And I have often talked about what happened in New York in the, I forget, 70s or 80s, but everything really went downhill. And it took them a long time, and I'm not sure they're still back, but, I mean, they've been working on it. But it costs a lot more to catch up than it does to stay even, and probably the same with your car. Staying in the flow of traffic doesn't take nearly as much gas as if you have to accelerate. And so we had a good group. We felt good about our recommendation and the support that we got. And it's just so long ago, it's hard to remember all the things we decided.
Thank you very much, Mr. Anderson.
Thank you. Yeah, I'm glad. I was going to suggest that you fill out a speaker slip. And it seems like if that report contains, if we go forward with something, that report be part of our outreach, especially since members of the public worked so hard on it and drew some conclusions that seem to be supported by factual data. And if I may take a liberty, Madam Mayor, to ask, we have a political consultant I respect in the audience. If he would, you know, I'd love to hear some ideas from a professional about the timing of our, if we go for a ballot initiative and other, you know, polling or other things that Brian Robinson might have an opinion on. So I'd love to see everybody come up to the mic. And I'm really grateful for this public discussion. Okay. Thank you.
Well, we'll invite Mr. Robinson up if he wants to come up during public comment. We could do that. Oh, you did. So that's good. Mr. White and then
yeah,
Mr. Yeah,
to address Ms. Murillo's question about the police vote, police station vote, A critical difference is that there was an assessment done of the police building. Meanwhile, in the early vote, it was more of the sort of the comfort and convenience and space needs of the police. And of course, now they rent the building next door as part of their space needs. But now we know there are health and safety issues there. The issues are much more substantial and they're well documented. So that, I think, is a significant difference.
Mr. Okay, so I have some public comment here. I have a number of people who are waiving their time to someone else. The way that works, you have to be in the room when I call your name out for your 2 minutes to count. And you don't have a timer, but I have a timer here, and so when your time is up, you're going to hear this. Oops, wait, no, you're not going to hear that. You're going to hear this. I think. No? Oh, it might help to. There we go. Let's try this again. Technical difficulties here. Let's. All right, that means your time is up. Okay, all right. So, there we go. All right, so we'll start first. So, James Smith. And so, let me just make sure all your. The people who want to waive their time to you are here. Eric Tomickson, are you there? Thank you. Kurt Forney. Deborah Weaver?
She had to leave, Your Honor.
Okay.
It's a difficult time to.
Understood. That's why we're taping this so people can watch it. Henry Schulte?
Here.
And Robert Stevens? Okay. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. You have up to 10 minutes.
Good morning, Mayor Schneider and members of the council. My name is Jim Smith. And the first thing I'd like to make very clear here this morning is staff has gone on for about an hour and a half. I hope that you're more interested in content than you are in watching the time. With that said, I was born and raised in Santa Barbara. and I've lived and worked in Santa Barbara my entire life. I'm concerned, and that's why I come before you this morning. I'm concerned because the city's out looking for sources of revenue. And I can tell you there's not a whole lot of revenue left in my pocket. Every governmental institution known to man is looking for sources of revenue. More concerning to me, especially after listening to staff, is that you are being led to believe, or you believe, that the way to resolve the city's financial challenges is to load taxes up on the backs of the fine citizens. There are other ways to do it. I've looked at the city budget, I've looked at the financial statement, and I've looked at other financial information put out by your city. I'm not a CPA, I'm not an accountant, I don't have a fine staff like you have assisting you. I'm just a little guy trying to roll his pebble up the hill. And here's what I glean from the information I've looked at. This city does have a financial crisis, and I'm confused. On one hand, I hear we don't have a financial crisis. On the other hand, I hear you talking about declaring a declaration of financial emergency. Here's what I see. I see a city that has $134.6 million in long-term debt. I see a city that has approximately $440 million in unfunded infrastructure needs. And I see a city that has $144 million in unfunded pension liability. Now that adds up to $718.6 million. And there is some confusion regarding your unfunded pension liability. In October of 2012, a city official was quoted as saying that the actual unfunded pension liability is $267 million. For purposes of today, let's leave it at $144 million in unfunded pension liability. Now, assuming the city is not immune from inflation, and assuming that the city pays interest on its long-term debt, and we put in a 3% factor for that, your underlying liability of $718 million is going to increase at over $20 million a year until that principal liability is reduced. And I don't see it being reduced anytime soon. Now, there's another factor that I think you should be aware of, and that is you're talking about loading up the people of this city through various means to raise $10 million. And I ask you, how's $10 million going to solve $718 million underlying liability? That's increasing at $20 million a year. Additionally, when you increase your sales tax revenue above 8%, you enter into a very exclusive club. Less than 33% of the entire cities in the state of California have a sales tax of 8% or higher. Four cities in this state have declared bankruptcy: San Bernardino, Mammoth Lakes, Stockton, and Alameda. Nine cities, and soon to be 10, have declared financial emergencies, which is the precursor to going into bankruptcy. Moody's has stated that there's four additional cities in the state of California, some of our largest cities, that will be going into bankruptcy in the future. Every single one of those cities has a sales tax of 8% or higher. Now, there is a solution, and there is a solution that I think infuses this city with capital, doesn't impose a burden on the people, and in a word, it's outsourcing. I know you outsource. Marburg is a great example, and what a fine organization that is, and what a great partnership. like to share with you some information outsourcing. Not a new concept, not a novel concept. 1954, it was started by the city of Lakewood, California. They outsource today. Their unfunded pension liability is less than 9%. Yours is about 40%. I'd also like to share with you some information about a city very similar to Santa Barbara. It's the city of Sandy Springs, Georgia. Similar in some respects, but different than others. It's also known as the city that outsourced everything. Sandy Springs has a population virtually identical to Santa Barbara. Relative to Georgia, it has higher or elevated housing prices, as does Santa Barbara. Median age is approximately the same. Land mass is a little larger. They have a little more infrastructure. That's where the differences stop. Sandy Springs has no unfunded pension liability. It has no unfunded infrastructure needs. It has no long-term debt. It has virtually the same population, exclusive of police and fire. They've got seven city employees. There's more city employees here than Sandy Springs has in their entire city. Now, we've heard a lot about, well, gee, we've cut down on expenditures on our employees, but you've also cut down on services. Sandy Springs' level of service is unbelievable. You can call them 7 days a week, 24 hours a day, 365 days a year. There's no furlough days. And you will get a very cheerful person who answers the phone and says, how can I help you? And if they can't help you, they'll pass you on to one of the other six employees who will help you. And if none of them can help you, their policy is, we'll get back to you in 72 hours. I've been working in this city for over 35 years, and I have dealt with your city offices, and I can tell you the level of service is nowhere near that. And I can also tell you that they're doing it on a 7% sales tax. Now,
you have about 2 minutes left.
2 minutes. Would you like me to stop, or could I finish what I think is meaningful?
I was just letting you know how much time you have left. I stopped the clock. You have 2 minutes left.
Anybody who knows about Sandy Springs may say, well, gee, it's only a city of 5 years. That's true. But there are other cities that have outsourced. Philadelphia has outsourced $290 million savings. San Jose has outsourced, and they are on the ropes. They outsourced janitorial service, $4 million, by just outsourcing. That's half of what you're trying to raise here, by just outsourcing one service. And so in conclusion, and I wish I did have more time because I have more valuable information to share with you, I see you've got two choices. You can load up the taxpayers with another tax, which is going to treat the symptom and not the problem, and you're going to kick the can down the road. The other thing you can do is you can implement meaningful change. Reach out. You can shape the future. And you can control the future by outsourcing. But in order to do that, you are going to have to leave the old tired ways of the past behind. And yes, some city employees may get discharged. And if you're worried about that, then I think I have more confidence in the city employees than you do. I hear time and again staff coming before you saying how great the city employees are doing. Well, if they're doing that great, they are going to get snapped up in private industry in a heartbeat. And if they aren't going to get snapped up, well, then we have to wonder why you have them on staff. And for the life of me, I do not understand if outsourcing provides a better service, higher quality, at a more affordable rate, why wouldn't you do it? Your allegiance lies here with the city and the citizens, not with the employees. And I would really urge you to consider it, and I promise you, as
Thank
I conclude, I promise you, you will check with staff. They'll give you 100 reasons why not to outsource. I've just given you 718 million reasons why you can. It can be done. Please consider it. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Smith. Leslie Wiscombe, and
I'd
then
like to ask a question.
Go ahead, Mr. Hotchkiss.
So the savings you're speaking of is entirely pension, is that correct? By outsourcing?
No. I did a poor job of explaining myself. Unfortunately, for perhaps municipalities, private industry is incredibly efficient these days. And so when you outsource, for example, San Jose outsourced their janitorial service, what they were paying the public employees, they are now paying private industry. And the disparity between the costs to provide janitorial services is $4 million. And thank you for asking the question and giving me just a little bit more time. Here's what I don't understand. When you folks let your contracts for public works, and I've been personally involved in them, you do a magnificent job. You demand that that private contractor provide the highest quality at the absolute most affordable price. In fact, that's what's required by the public contract code. Why in the world don't you apply the same standard when it comes to services that are performed by your city employees?
Okay, so your point is both it's efficiency of private industry and minimal or no pension costs.
No.
Don't go on forever with this. Try to be brief.
No. I don't have all the comparisons, but some are. Yeah, they probably have lower pension costs. They probably don't have the enormous benefits that the public employees have, time off, furlough, medical, on and on. Most of them, the ones I deal with, do have benefits, but certainly not the lavish benefits. Believe me, the benefits this city provides, I can't afford for myself.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Mr. Russ also has a question. Mr. Smith?
I wonder, Mr. Smith, since you seem to have put some effort into this information gathering, if you could develop a brief of some kind to provide us with.
I'd be happy to. And the one thing I want, thank you for opening up the door again. One thing I would like to say is, and I would be happy to do that, is there's one thing I haven't mentioned because of time, and that is San Diego. They are doing what's called managed competition, which is a step between completely outsourcing and sticking with your in-city employees, which is if your city employees want to bid on a job, let them bid on it. And if the private industry can come in and underbid them, then it goes to private industry. If the public employees can underbid, they get it. San Diego did that, and the public employees underbid for street sweeping services, and the city saved $2 million.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Leslie Wiscombe.
Oh, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
And then Brian Robinson.
Good morning, Madam Mayor and members of City Council. I'm Leslie Wiscombe. I'm chairman of the Parks and Recreation Commission. As you know, the Parks and Recreation Department manages close to 50% of the general fund facilities within the city and has significant unfunded infrastructure needs. Given the community's desire to restore and enhance services within the city, I think the time has come to begin rebuilding. And as we focus on options for increasing revenues in the general fund, we hope that the needs of the Parks and Recreation Department will become a top priority. I was pleased to see Mr. Armstrong's slide of the Community Enhancement Fund, as he called it, with the Parks and Recreation Department at the top of the list. I think we all know that there are significant deferred maintenance issues and significant ways we can really help the community if we have some money to rebuild some of these facilities that we have. So the commission hopes that you will consider options to increase revenue and that will fund some of the Parks and Recreation Department's significant needs. Thank you.
Thank you. Brian Robinson.
Mayor Schneider, members of the council, thanks for this opportunity. This is a great workshop, and there's discussion of why do measures fail, why are they successful, and I can tell you that every successful tax measure that's happened in the past 20 years has started with this deliberate conversation, asking the tough questions, addressing issues, and so this is a great start. I had took a lot of little bit of notes and things. With respect to the question of turnout, yes, the on-cycle elections significant in the city of Santa Barbara. You know, you're somewhere between 70% and 90% turnout in those times. So there are considerations for that and the benefits of that. There are also considerations for an off-cycle election and the what was discussed earlier. So that's one thing. Accountability, I think, is really important with the voters, and so the advisory measure issue is great. I also am a fan of specific taxes. Just personally, me speaking as a voter, not as a elections consultant. But that being said, don't be afraid of two-thirds and the research that you do, if you so choose to do research. You know, we'll really ferret out what those issues are. I mean, there's many different mechanisms, as you discussed, for generating revenue through legislative means, and so it sounds like you're really considering all those, and that's good. Timing's really important, that window of opportunity you have, the runway you have, and what is really important for us, what was talked earlier about the electorate and where they are on these issues and how to educate them. So we've done a lot of public information for municipalities and jurisdictions. Last election, we did some public information for the city of Goleta and their transient occupancy tax. So it can be done. It's important to do, but again, it depends. And I'm here to answer any questions, so thank you.
Thank you.
May I ask him a question?
Go ahead, Ms. Maria.
Mr. Robinson, were you here in 99 when we tried that to rebuild
yes.
the police station? Did you have any thoughts on that, sir?
Election night, I was watching the returns come in. I think it's like everything with respect to why measures win and why measures lose. I mean, it was a combination of things. I think one of the things is, and if you look at a lot of the measures that aren't successful, and I think, in the chart, if you pulled out those cities and counties and other folks that weren't successful, a lot of them didn't do this research. That there wasn't polling on whether or not the voters supported that type of an issue. So it's happened here in a variety of issues in the county. And so I just think that the research and being very deliberate about that and appreciating all of the issues. And with respect to polling, you talked about that, and polling's just not polling. This is a feasibility study that you'd be paying a consultant to do. So it talks about the electoral environment. Talks about the makeup of voters. It talks about a variety. So, for instance, if you hired us, we would talk about, okay, what does this November election look like? What's the next November election look like? What's a special election look like? And so the variety of ways that you could do that. So it's not just do voters support taxes, taxing themselves. It's Parks and Rec is important, or is public safety important? Where's the will of the electorate on those issues? So I think that's, and more often than not, we tell clients that they're just not ballot ready. That's what we're looking for. Are you guys ready to go on the ballot? So, I hate to go back and revisit things. I think you have to move forward, and there's a lot to learn from measures that aren't successful. There's a lot to learn from measures that are successful, but I think you just have to look at your in as a unique set of circumstances and a unique set of time with a unique electorate.
Thank you. There was a request for a mini break before we get to deliberation, so why don't we take about five, no longer than 7 minutes, okay? And we'll come back. Any other questions? Okay. So personally, I think it's pretty important that all of us speak on what we're thinking at this moment because we need to give staff some sort of direction. I know Councilmember House is ill, which is unfortunate he's not here today. I know he has expressed concern about how we're going to fund various things, but how we get there, I don't know. I can't get in his head, but I know the concern is there and wanting to find some solution. I think I can say that on his behalf.
So how do we want to start? We just go down the line? Which end? Dale, you want to start?
Sure.
Okay.
Thank you. The problems that we face here as a city in funding necessary city services are not that different than other cities in the state of California. One of the gentlemen who was speaking earlier brought up the point that we have several cities in California that are either in bankruptcy now or on the verge of it. And I believe every one of those cities has their own pension system. And that, generally speaking, is the cause not only of a lot of local city financial difficulties, but difficulties throughout the state. And there's a general problem with politicians overpromising certain constituencies, whether they be the public employee unions or particular corporate or farming interests, what the state and what the people of the state can provide for them. We've seen that problem here to some extent. And my feeling is the state in general is going to have to find ways of funding operations other than simply continuing to raise taxes on people. Locally, there may be support for this sort of thing if it's focused enough. But personally, what I would like to see is, as we continue, I hope, knock on wood if there were any wood here, as we continue to move out of the recession and into an improving economy, I would like to see this council demonstrate some continued fiscal discipline. The danger that I see with an improving economy is that we go back to the old ways of funding things. I don't know what the current number is, but the number in the past for the general fund share that goes to salary and benefits has been around 78%. And that obviously is the big cost driver. That's something that we have to, I believe, demonstrate to the taxpayers that we will control even in the good times, not just when we're in the midst of a terrible recession. So personally, I think that we as a council need to demonstrate to the people of this city that we will keep costs down, that we're serious about efficiency even in the good times. When you look at the wage and benefit packages that we provide for city workers, they are very, very good compared to the private sector. I think a lot of people in the city would be astonished at how good they are if they knew the details. And so what I believe that we're going to have to do in the coming years is make sure that there's some equity there, that the public employees are paying their fair share of the city's costs, just like the taxpayers are, the other taxpayers. And I want to make sure that we demonstrate good stewardship when it comes to finances before we consider increasing further the tax burden on people in the city. Thank you.
Thank you. I believe we should be spending the public monies carefully. And at the same time, providing needed services. They go together. In terms of the options that you've put up there for us, I support assessing the community support for raising revenues through polling. I believe the public wants to support public services, and especially city services, especially those that have been cut. First of all, our parks are used by locals, and they're a tourist attraction. I know when I go to other cities, I like to visit the parks. They're also a revenue source. People have their weddings and other things there, so they should look good and offer robust botanical resources. And people talk about the parks looking shabby, and I'm not sure if it's an aesthetic sense that we have. And certainly my heart is in finding revenue again for our parks, again, for our libraries. The libraries are not just a place to go get books. If we're talking about preventing children from going into gangs, they need to have a place to study. And that's the quality of life that I'm talking about that the city needs to provide. Restorative policing is important. It helps the vulnerable population of homeless people, and it addresses the quality of life issues in our public spaces, and it honors the desire of the business community to have an attractive place for tourists to come. So I think if we invest in the city, if we find revenue sources, we create more revenue through being an attractive city. And then I'd like to say that I have the utmost respect for our staff, and I wish Mr. Smith were still here and his friends, that I believe there's a way to express yourself without demonizing our staff or talking about our public employees having lavish benefits. They're good benefits, and people deserve to be paid well and to live with an amount of security in their lives, and some of us believe in that. And right, don't give away the store, and we have to address our pension liability, but there's a way to do that respectfully. And so I, you know, if there's public employees who heard that negativity, I would just like to say that I honor their service, and I honor the work that you've done to bring these ideas to us. And I believe that we're all working for the good of the city of Santa Barbara. And I am supportive of looking at new revenue sources. Thank you, Madam Mayor.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Well, I think it's going to be interesting to see, and probably polling is not a bad idea, what the appetite for any kind of increase will be on the heels of Prop 30 and our parcel taxes having passed recently. Prop 30, as people look into it and look at what the revenue sources were supposed to be used for and what they are used for, is going to prove to be a pretty large shell game in most people's view. And taxpayers are already rightfully cynical about what people in government do with funding sources. I would actually, I should have probably asked this question before this period, but I might ask Mr. Wiley to come to the microphone just because I want to either, I'd like to define or redefine this advisory addendum to a general vote on a sales tax, for example, and how binding that is, how controlling that is, and how much we can really say to a future council, this is what these money shall be spent on.
Mr. Rouse, I have to apologize. It's not a simple answer, so I'm going to go on for a minute or two. And
probably not long.
And of course, just to be real clear, this is in distinguishing between a general tax and a special tax, because it's real clear now that if you want to do a special tax, it requires a two-thirds voter approval. You know, there's an inherent dichotomy in this now. Special taxes, I think, generally can be received positively because people are told, taxpayers are told, this is what this money will go for, and this is the only thing. For example, if you need a new jail, and you know, some of the cases involve counties building new jails, and you see that there's been voter approval for a special tax, it was to build something that you absolutely need like that, or to improve your road system. But at the same time, it requires a two-thirds approval. You know, I think the best way to answer your question is to just briefly read from a case decided in 1998 that is the origin of what we're talking about. It's a case called Coleman versus County of Santa Clara. And when we speak of this AB approach, it's very common now in this context to talk about submitting to the voters an AB approach. There's two things on the ballot, one advisory and one is the actual tax measure. But let me read from this case, and I think it just explains it, or the narrative, you can follow it pretty easily. This is the court starts with a summary of the county council's analysis. This was a November of 1996 election in the county of Santa Clara. Measure A provides in relevant part, italics, this measure is not, capital N-O-T, not a tax. It is an advisory measure that states Santa Clara County voters' intent that any new sales tax fund be spent on a list of transportation improvements. And then it included this list of transportation improvements. And again, just this is the county council summarizing this Measure A. It also provides that administrative expenses will be limited to 0.5% of the funds, and that all projects will be implemented within 9 years. Then the court states, in his analysis, the county council reiterated that the measure was advisory only. He explained that an advisory measure is not controlling on the sponsoring legislative body, in other words, in this case, the Board of Supervisors. In other words, the opinion expressed through the vote on this advisory measure, while of interest to the County Board of Supervisors, is not in any manner legally controlling on the Board of Supervisors' use of the sales tax proceeds. Right there, and that's, I think, why the court started with this. The legal challenge was what happened in Santa Clara, a special tax or a general tax, and ultimately they concluded that it was a general tax, and it only required a majority approval because despite this advisory measure, the county council was real clear, this is a general tax, and it's going into the county's general fund. And in fact, it goes on to say it makes it real clear the money is going into the general fund and could be spent for any county governmental purpose. Then there's Measure B. This is the second thing that the county put on the ballot. Measure B provides a relevant part. This measure authorizes the enactment of a half-cent retail transaction and use tax for general county purposes. It further requires the tax to expire in 9 years. That's the common, fairly common sunset provision. And it creates the Independent Citizens Watchdog Committee, which must regularly publish reports on how the sales tax revenues are being spent. The county council opined that Measure B was a general tax because it is to be used for general county purposes. The court, makes it clear, or the county council makes it clear, the county is not in any way legally bound to use the tax monies for any special purposes or for any particular project or projects. The way they did this, it became a moral obligation on the Board of Supervisors, or maybe moral and political obligation, and it worked for them. And I think you can see that there's kind of this connection with the sunset provision that people wouldn't forget because this is only a 9-year measure, what they were promised when they approved this. But I think it's interesting in this case, for example, that they created this independent watchdog committee, because I know one of the questions that we've had is, well, can you account for these monies separately, even though they're going into the general fund? I guess in a way you have a sub-fund of the general fund where you really keep track of a general tax proceeds. And I read this to say, yeah, you can, because if you've got a watchdog committee that's supposed to do an annual report explaining where the money's being spent, I assume you're going to have to account for it very separately and very, very, very clearly. So that's what we call the A-B approach, where you actually do a sales tax that goes into the general fund, but the voters are promised that it will be only spent for certain purposes, but that promise is not legally binding. And you'll see, and it happened in this case, and I've seen it in the election process, the proponents and the opponents do not miss this. And the arguments over the opponents, for example, will say, but they could use it for raises in year 7. And that's true enough, but for the fact that perhaps they would feel politically and morally bound not to do that. And they would catch all kinds of flack, presumably, if they tried that. But I hope that answers
your
question.
Appreciate that clarification. That's exactly what I was looking for. When Mr. Smith was testifying, and I'll disagree with Ms. Marino. I don't think he was demonizing our staff or employees. I think he was demonizing elected officials in general for making some of the decisions that we do make that end up in these situations. Some decisions that it's easy to look back at the past and see what happened and kind of go, wow, how could you go down that road? But in fact, that kind of answer that Mr. Wiley gave me says we can make decisions and have intents and say what we're going to say,
but our ability to control a future council's decision-making on any given Tuesday is pretty small. And I think that's where the voter intent comes in. That's the what we're supposed to be the stewards of. And I really believe that we'd have to proceed very carefully and very deliberately to maintain the public trust going forward on any kind of revenue enhancement. Thank you.
So you're saying yes to the polling to answer some questions. I just want to be clear of what you're...
Yes, I think depending on how and who decides or designs the poll, because that's always interesting to me how you ask those questions. But I would have to want to see that way before I have got into the proposition that we would do this and get the appetite of the people.
Thank you. Mr. White.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Well, it would be to no one's surprise that I am very supportive of improving our investment in infrastructure. It's been a watchword of what I've been talking about in my years on council. I've framed the issue for myself from the perspective of when I was a youngster, I inherited the best infrastructure in the world. I was in Southern California. The roads, the schools, the parks were top-notch. And that Prop 13 was one, it was the big bang that changed things. And I've, for one, benefited from that and enjoy the positive side of that. But it has skewed our financing system along the way. Our fuel tax as well is a fixed pennies on the federal and state level, or is a fixed penny amount rather than a percent. And that's another element that has starved our road infrastructure. I say these things because that's what I see 40 years later having caused the huge unfunded liabilities that we're looking at here. Mr. Francisco mentioned the retirement system. I support generous and retirement pensions, but they should be paid for by the people benefiting from those services. And that's where one of the ways that we got behind the eight ball is the folks that both the councils of the past and the employees of the past didn't, and I think there were good intentions along the way, but didn't fund the retirement after those employees have retired. And I think that's unfortunate. And obviously, there's been some real change with the state reforms. We've started turning the corner, but that's part of a big problem that we have. And definitely, I agree with Mr. Francisco about we need to keep squeezing the system to improve efficiencies as we go along. I think we have done a decent job over the last few years, and I certainly am committed to continuing there. I'm also one that I want to leave if my work on council, I would want to see us improving, leave a campground better than the way you found it. And so that sort of says to me, let's poll folks to find out if this community has the will to invest in, even if it's a relatively shorter sunset and we defer the big element, which is the police headquarters, I would see it as that requiring a longer commitment, let's say a 20-year tax rather than a 10. I think a 10 would get us over the hump on some of the immediate things that are starting to fall apart. As Mr. Jensen said, there's an acceleration of things falling apart as you defer maintenance longer. And if we could start getting a hold on that, I think that would help. So a 10-year window of funding is at least attractive to me for the moment. And obviously, I appreciate that we'd be asking the citizenry through a poll, perhaps trying to refine, as Mr. Robinson said, what that request would be. So that's kind of my take. And then perhaps in the longer term, I think, as Mr. Francisco said, the state and federal levels, there's got to be a bigger picture improvement here somewhere along the way, and hopefully, of course, an improving economy would all contribute to us having more money to invest. But I do think we need a kickstart of some kind to turn the corner and not let these deferring costs get away from us even further.
Mr. Hotchkiss?
Oh, thank you, Madam Mayor. I'm not sure what Mr. White meant by a kickstart, but I'll just avoid that.
May I clarify?
Please do.
Okay.
I think of a 10, let's just say it, we saw sunsets on there. One of the ways that many of these elections got passed was I would, at least as a citizen, I would feel more security if there's an end date out there that I can see. And so I say, let's just say a 10-year commitment for a sales tax increase. So that's what I meant by kickstart. And then it's done, and we'd be hopefully an improved economy would be in place, and we may not need that money, that additional tax going forward.
Okay. Well, there's no question we got unfunded liabilities and capital improvements and all that. But when somebody says a tax burden, it's exactly that. It's a burden. And for some people, it's even a minor increase is fatal, if I can put it that way. So I absolutely don't think that's the direction we should go in now. And maybe in a year we take a look at how our revenues have increased, changed, or whatever, but continue our conservative course, fiscally conservative, tight-fisted even, we could say. And if I were not a council person but a member of the public, I would feel a lot of confidence in elected officials that would say we have to do anything very, very cautiously, and now is not the time to put any kind of sales tax forward or any other tax. Thank you.
I want to thank great presentation, and again, thank City TV for sort of at the last minute to come to a place that's normally not taped, because I think having this information available will be really helpful. Just for the general public to know, because it's very complex. I see there are four issues here. Let's see if I can kind of remember the issues. One is the city needs to, and the council in its policies, needs to be as efficient as we possibly can with the public's money. And I think in Mr. Francisco has some good points, that we have to show that even when times are good or when times are bad or things are turning around, we have to be good stewards of the public's money. I think we need to do that each and every year. This year will be interesting with bargaining units and our collective bargaining process with the pension issue. I mean, it's ongoing. Nothing's been decided yet. Contracts are coming up. And what this council will do in working with our bargaining units on reducing that pension liability to the city is yet to come. But I think that will tell a big story and what we're able to accomplish. And I think a lot of the concerns that maybe were expressed earlier. So one is doing what we can. I think, frankly, the last few years with this budget, this council's done a very good job in providing the absolute essential services, adding on some things we thought were important, and not decimating the system and not sending a whole lot of people out to the unemployment line in the midst of a deep recession. I think we weathered that storm pretty well, and now the question is, how do we move forward? Acknowledging we have this very large gap of needs, not only for infrastructure, but things that people are asking us to provide. The restorative policing program is very popular. It's very the B coordinator is very popular, but perhaps not enough. Do we want something more robust? The park maintenance has been cut significantly. That can only last so long until our parks really start to lose its luster, and that creates a ripple effect in terms of how people view our parks and visit our parks and the safety of our parks. Library service is another one. As the economy picks up and there are more projects going through community development, that time is money. I've heard time and again from the business community that plan check and tenant improvement processes, we need more attention in terms of moving things around to make them more successful. That takes staff time, that takes money. So there are things that we know we want to do, and then the question is, how do you add to a budget that's pretty constrained the way it is? So that's telling the story and being efficient and being honest. I was thinking about the city of Los Angeles that had did not pass their sales tax. Now, frankly, going up to 9% might have been a shocker for the city of Los Angeles for their sales tax. But there was mixed messages out there. You know, is the city in fiscal crisis? How many police officers are you going to lose? Or, you know, the candidates who are running for mayor are saying a whole bunch of different things. There's money here. There's not money there. I mean, the message was very murky. And then 2 days after the election and it passed, and it didn't pass, the mayor of Los Angeles said, we're not really in a fiscal crisis. So I think we need to be, whatever we do, honest with our story and accurate to the voter, saying, as was said, the day-to-day operations of the city is doing okay with a status quo situation. Is what do we want to be as a city in terms of enhancing services or really dealing with these deferred maintenance and major infrastructure? Do we want to add more funds to make those things happen? We're not in dire straits. We're not on the brink of bankruptcy, and so we don't want to, you know, do any kind of sky is falling stories if we should move forward with something. The third thing is, frankly, we might be the ones to put something on the ballot, but it really is up to the voters of what they want. So, you know, they can't put something on the ballot. They can't have five of voters, but five of us can. But we're not saying do this and make it so. We're asking the voters, what do you think? And with the knowledge and with the story, they can tell us then, yes or no, I think that this is a good idea for the city of Santa Barbara. So really, I think it's almost incumbent upon us to ask the voters what they think. And so I'm hearing, you know, a poll, a feasibility study, whatever you want to call it. Before we go down the line of a process for a campaign, let's ask them. I think that is that's an important thing to do. And if there's no interest whatsoever, we stop right there. If there seems to be interest, then again, what we're doing is putting something on a ballot for their consideration. We have our opinions about it, but it's their decision. So that was three. And then four was reality. The reality of the complexity about how campaigns work, whether it's a two-thirds majority or a simple majority. I appreciate, and I've heard from the consultant, you know, from Mr. Robinson, I've heard from others, that it kind of feels easier and safer to do a specific tax. I understand that. I feel that intuitively. But looking at past actions in terms of moving forward, if we were to do all this effort, tell this story, rely on a campaign that's not to this, that the city's not running, and get 64% of the vote, a complete, you know, big majority of the electorate, but yet still not able to do what they asked us to do, I think we failed. Obviously, we failed. The measure failed. But doing something like an advisory measure, I think, you know, yes, a future council could change it, but if there's an ordinance of creating this community service fund or whatever you want to call it, you'd have to undo that ordinance as a vote in the public setting in order to change, you know, to change the process of where that money's being spent. And that, I think, gives the public a little more protection, a little more comfort, and still allows us with a majority vote. I think we've come to the conclusion that a TOT increase doesn't bring you money, and we are way at the top anyway. Really, we're looking at a sales tax measure, if anything. But I think first we need to ask the voters through some polling or something just to see what their appetite is. Because I agree with you, Mr. Hotchkiss, that, or was it Mr. White, saying, you know, we just got out of Prop 30 and two school bonds, and City College is talking and other people are talking. So let's, you know, let's find out what they're thinking today. Obviously, I'm not hearing a unanimity of putting anything on the ballot, so certainly 2014 is not an option. That's what I'm hearing here. But there's a question of whether or not there are five votes to put something on for this November, and I think we need that community feedback first before making that decision. So I think that I think summarized what we're all saying. Anything else from any of us? Mr. Hotchkiss.
Yeah, I mean, it always sounds nice to say, well, let's see what people think, but I think $25,000 could be spent better, and we should push this off for a year.
But, Mr. Hotchkiss, you're saying you don't want anything on the ballot. If we push it off for a year, we need your vote to put something on.
Yeah, we would down the line. Make that decision.
You would make that decision. Yeah, no, we wouldn't have your vote down the line? Down. Okay. All right. I just want to be clear where that would go. Ms. Maria.
Assuming that Councilmember House is supportive of raising revenue, what can we do with four votes, Mr. Armstrong?
Nothing, I don't think.
Yeah, I think with, well, you couldn't do a sales tax with four votes based upon what Mr. Wiley said in terms of state law. It would be five votes if you wanted to put something on.
Right. Thank you.
Go ahead.
That was it.
So, yes, Mr. White.
To try to move this along, I support the assessing the community support through polling, and the sales tax being the vehicle for going forward with an A-B approach is kind of the package that I would like to see examined. And I think that I like having it on the city election. Because it's focused, it's the topic at hand. Obviously, the vote count is also. I like that it's at least five. Obviously, the way our council is constructed, it shows a broader base of support than kind of the cliche lines of philosophy. So I like that. I like the broad base. So that would be my preference, and I would. Is a motion appropriate to do that?
I don't think we are agendized for a motion.
Okay.
It's just giving
I'll just express that preference in any case.
And maybe I could, based upon what I'm hearing, at least from four members of council, that there is support for polling. And what I would recommend is we'll do an accelerated process, maybe not an RFP. We'll just contact the top polling companies that we're aware of, ask them for some proposals. And we would schedule that on a city council agenda where you would then know what the cost is, a better idea of what that polling company would do, and then the council at that point could make a decision, do you want to go forward with polling? And we would do that relatively quickly within the next 30 days because you start working on the clock, and then again, then the council would have a choice at that point, do you want to go forward with the polling or not, and you'd have a better feel for what that would cost. That's kind of what I hear a majority of the council saying you're supportive of.
Right. And to clear, Mr. Rouse, you were supportive of moving forward with that item to come back to council?
Yes, because I believe that the pulse of the community is important. We all have our individual philosophies and our outlooks on taxes and citizen reaction. But to actually give them the opportunity to say yay or nay or get a feel for the percentage of sample that it says it's a good idea or don't do it now, wait. I think that's essential information for us up here.
Okay.
And one of the areas, and I'm just thinking out loud, is at that point we might also recommend that the council have like a three-member ad hoc committee that would work with the polling company on the actual questions. I think that's just to accelerate the process so that you guys could be engaged in that process. And
do what you need to give you who that's
no, we would bring that as part of the item.
Item.
Because you may.
Okay.
When we bring it to you, that you may not like the cost or something, and you may say, no, we don't want to go forward with it. So that would be the time you would make that decision. And then, again, at least my thinking right now would be at the same time we would say and appoint a three-member committee to work with the staff and the polling group to kind of develop the questions and give input on it.
Okay. Okay. Any other comments or questions? Okay. Thank you very much. This meeting's adjourned.
Thank you.